This is the joint work with Professor Raja Sridhar and Dr. Sunil Kumar Yadav. In this talk, I will talk about the notion of algebraic fundamental group. I hope everyone familiar with the fundamental group for some topological space. So before starting anything, so I will talk about something about unimodulus. What is the unimodulus and what is the relevance of this unimodulus and how this is important to work on this unimodulus. So before starting anything, so I will fix this ring as a commutative ring with identity. But whenever I talk about the ring, that means I take the commutative ring with identity. And so let us fix first GLNR. GLNR is the set of all invertible matrices with entries from R, and then SLNR is the set of all invertible matrices with determinant 1. Now after these two groups, I will define another group which is just like which is generated by elementary matrices, and that is called elementary group. That is called elementary group. So if you take ring is a field, especially ring is a field, then ENR is nothing but SLNR. But this is not always true. If you take for arbitrary ring, it is not true. So and then everyone is know that a vector space module theory over a ring is a generalization of a vector space over a field. And you know every vector space has a basis, but so one can ask whether a module has a basis. So it is not true, for especially if you want to see an example of a non-free module, just take any ring and take the ideal and take the quotient. The quotient R by I becomes an module over R, but it cannot be a free module over R. Free means those module which has a basis, that is called free module. So now that means it is interesting to know when a module is free. So then people are working like that on that way. So now so a module which is just not free but directs some amount of a free module is called projective module. That means P directs some Q is free, then P is called projective module. So now I will going to define for a particular case of this projective module. It is called stably free. Stably free means P directs some Rm is free. So that is this is the particular case of projective module. So this is stably free module. Now after stably free module, I am going to define what is the unimodular row. So unimodular, if take any vector in Rn, and if the ideal generated by that vector, that elements of that vector is whole R, that is called unimodular row. So that means if it you know, if you take any non-zero vector, suppose I am taking a field F and taking a non-zero vector in Fn. So once we take a non-zero vector in that that Fn, so it can always extend to that vector to a basis, to a basis of Fn. So that means that means we can get an invertible matrix such that the first column will becomes that that vector. Right, so the same thing I'm going to define in any ring. So that means if you take any non-zero vector, if you're able to find an invertible matrix with entries from R, so the first column is that one is called computable. Right, but we cannot do for a vector space F in Fn. If you take a non-zero vector in Fn, that we can always do that one. But for the ring case, we cannot do always. So that's why called computable. If you take any non-zero vector, if you are able to find a matrix, invertible matrix, first column is that one. It's called computable unimodular row, and the set of all unimodular rows over R will denote EMNR. Now, so we say that two vectors are related by an invertible matrix if the alpha times that vector is equal to another vector. Similarly, one can define for SLNR and ENR also. Now, so I'm come on to discuss what is the this how one can see this unimodulus is very important to theory of commutative algebra. So in 1955, Sayers asked one question that whether a projective module over a polynomial ring over a field is free. So this question is settled in 1976 by Kulin and Suslin independently. They gave their own way to they proved this conjecture by their own way. Now. But after 2 or 3 years, Sayers itself proved that every projective module over polynomial ring is a stably free module, right? As I already defined. So then people are to see this conjecture. People are working on a stably free module. So when a stably free module is free, So now then you can see that by definition, by the definition of stably free module, stably free module is nothing but the kernel of some surjective homomorphism from Rn to Rm. So that means you can see if you take the matrix of this epimorphism, that becomes a right invertible rectangular matrix. So that means the study of stably free module is nothing but the study of solution space of right invertible rectangular matrix. Right. So, and you can see that if this stably free module is free, if this F can be extended to the an isomorphism from Rn to R. Right. So that means what does it mean? It means that solution stably free module is free. That means the right invertible matrix can be completed to invertible matrix by adding few rows. So that is the case. So that means by using this result, one can see this one stably free module is free is the same thing as unimodular row over R can be completed to an invertible matrix. So that means to study the freeness of stably free module, it is equivalent to see just completeness of the unimodular rows. So that means unimodular rows becomes the important to study this in this way. So now I'm going to talk about something about unimodular rows some more. So if you take any unimodular row, so you can see it gives a map from Rn to R, which is the surjective homomorphism, homomorphism, module homomorphism. So then take the kernel. Then you'll see the Rn can be written as the kernel of F direct sum R. So that means this kernel of F becomes a stably free module of type 1. And this is called projective module corresponding to the unimodular rows. And we have seen that this unimodular row is completable if and only if this kernel is Rn is R. Is isomorphic to Rn minus 1, right? We took the n length unimodular rows, and then this P, even it is isomorphic to Rn minus 1. So this question becomes interesting to when does a unimodular row completable? So for example, if you are in a field or a PID, then every unimodular row is completable. So and similarly for Euclidean domain and all. So now if you take any modular row of length 2. That is also computable, just like take a1 a2, then by definition a1 b1 plus a2 b2 is 1 for some a2 b2. So that then take this matrix, this is a matrix, invertible matrix with determinant 1. So you can say this is any modular of length 2 is always computable. Now next one says that if you take any unimodular row which has a shorter length of unimodular, that is also computable. So I will not go the this proof, but this proof is given. If anyone interested, I can talk about this one. And also, if you take any unimodular which is one, at least one entry is unit, then it is also completable. The same proof will work. The previous proof is work. Now, similarly, if you add local ring means it has only one maximal ideal, then every unimodular is again completable. Now, so people and if you take over semi-local ring, also the same result will hold. Now, I am going to give the example of unimodular row where this is not completable. Means, if you take this coordinate ring of a sphere, this R x1, x2, y, x and centered by x1 square plus x2 square plus x2 minus 1. This is the coordinate ring of a sphere. And if you take the small xi, is the image of capital xi, and then small x1, x2, xn becomes a unimodular row over this ring. And the projective module given by this unimodular row is only free if n equal to 1, 2, 4 and 8 and otherwise not. And this is proved by topological technique. So I will not go to the details, but this gives the examples of non-completable unimodular rows. Right, so then it is interesting to see. And now I'm going to talk about this algebraic fundamental group. So algebraic fundamental group, I hope everyone is familiar with the fundamental group of topological space. So before starting anything, I will talk about what is the definition of algebraic fundamental group. So you can connect the definition of the fundamental group of a topological space. So if you say X is a topological space, I mean now how one can define the fundamental group of that space at a point. So just take a loop at that point and then they define a relation, take the equivalence classes, and that becomes a group under some operation, right? So the same technique, if you take any ring I'm taking a loop in SL to RT. That means SL to RT, the starting and ending point is identity matrix. So that with those matrices, collect those matrices in SL to RT whose alpha 0 and alpha 1 are identity. Now I'm going to define the relation as just like the fundamental of topological space. I will say that we call these elements of this L as a loop. So we say that two loops, alpha T and beta T, are related. If you get an matrix, 2x2 matrix, invertible matrix with determinant 1 in RTS, such that gamma T0 is alpha T and gamma T1 is beta T, and gamma 0S and gamma 1 is identity, that means 2x2 matrix. So you can see this is just like the homotopy between these two loops. So that it is called gamma T is a homotopy between alpha T and beta T. And it is easy to verify this relation is an equivalence relation. Now take the all equivalence classes of loops based on I2, and this forms an abelian group with respect to the binary operation. Just define alpha T star beta T is alpha T, class of alpha T into beta T. And we denote this is pi 1 SL 2 R, and we call it as an algebraic fundamental group of ring R. Now I'm going to motivate how why we define this this group. And so first of all, I will suppose you have a topological space, then you take this set of all continuous map from X to R. This is a ring, right? It is well known thing. And also if you see the continuous map X to Rn, this is direct sum of continuous X R. Now let us fix the continuous X to pi 1 S. I'm giving the heuristic idea of this group. So continuous X to pi 1 SL to R is just nothing but a pi 1 SL to continuous X R. One can see by taking the elements. Now you can see, and you know the fundamental group of SL to R is Z. As a topological space, the fundamental group SL to R at point I 2 is Z. So that means this pi 1 SL2 continuous XR is nothing but a continuous X to Z, right? And so that means, and you can see the continuous X to Z set up all continuous map from X to Z. If X is connected, then this group is isomorphic to Z only, right? So that means this continuous X to Z, it depend on the connected components of the topological space X.
Yeah, so that kya hai magnitude?
What is that? Is there any problem?
Right? No, sir. So, you can continue.
So, right. Okay. Thank you. So therefore, this group pi 1 SL 2 R is related to the connectedness of somehow is related to the connectedness. So this is one way. Maybe this is perhaps well known motivation about that. Now I'm going to give another motivation. So just like if you take the exponential map from C to C star, C is the complex number, C to C star, then it will be we can get an exact sequence from 0 to Z to C and C star by exponential map. Now just take any topological space and take the continuous map, so that they will get the second one. But this is not exact in the right hand side, because you know the every function from X to C star need not find logarithm. Right, so they will get only this way. Now, by the same idea, now if you replace this C by R2, so then I want to construct a sequence like 1 for R2 case. So this is the this one will get by the idea of universal construction of universal covering space of a topological space. So that means, if you take C star, replace C star by R2 minus 0 and take the equivalence classes of paths from 0, 1 to R2 minus 0 with the same starting point, right? Then and define the map from E to R2 minus 0, just like alpha goes to path alpha goes to alpha at the its endpoint. Then this gives a surjective map from this space E to R2 minus 0. And if you look at the kernel means, if suppose I'm fixing the one point here, then kernel means those elements which goes to that point. So that will exactly the fundamental group of R2 minus 0 at that point, right? So you will get this sequence which is similar to 0 to Z2 like that, right? So if R is the field of real numbers, and then I define the new order of length 2. That is nothing but is R2 minus 0. Hence, this pi 1 R2 minus 0, you can think as a pi 1 of EM2R. In fact, we can write the sequence 3 as like that, this sequence 3 dash. Right? So then, so now if you suppose I'm taking a polynomial, polynomial, then you can think polynomial as a function from, suppose I'm taking a polynomial of n variable, then you can take that polynomial as a function from Rn to R, right? Just evaluating this one. So by the same thing, if you take any ring, R is the coordinating of a real affine value, real points XR, then if you take any element of that ring, that you can think this is as a function from XR to R. So that way, if you take the on this three dash, we take the continuous functor, then we'll get this again. We get the this sequence, right? And every unimodular row, as I said, gives a continuous map from XR to R2 minus zero. We can say that. So EM2R is nothing but the algebraic analog of this XR to R2 minus zero. So this means this sequence above, you can think as a four dash. That means the first continuous XR pi 1 UM2 R is just 1 to pi 1 UM2 R, and E this one another space, and last one the UM2 R. Right. So then this Bach and Garge recently developed this notion of this group for any ring using the theory of global action, and which is applicable in many other, but I will not go in that way. So this is one of the motivation of this one, but it is UM2R. This structure UM2R doesn't have any group structure. So this professor Rajasthan got and this newly suggested to professor Rajasthan to replace this UM2R by SL2R, and SL2R has a group structure. So by that way, you get to if you take space X as SL2R and apply the same idea of construction of universal covering space. That one, you get the same thing as like R2 minus 0, you get an exact sequence 5. And similarly, if you take the continuous of from X, you take R is a coordinating of real affine variety X with real point XR, then take the continuous of that one, you'll get the next sequence. Similarly, just like as I said, if you take any polynomial that gives a map from R, the thing that is map from Rn to R. Similarly, if you take any element of SL to R, that gives a continuous map from XR to SL2R. So that means this SL2R can think as an algebraic analog of this space, continuous XR to SL2R. So by that way, this pi 1 SL2R is the algebraic analog of continuous XR to pi 1 SL2R. And you know the pi 1 SL2R is nothing but Z. So this pi, for any ring, the algebraic fundamental group is just the group H0 XR to Z. H0 XR Z is the set of all continuous map from XR to Z. And this group is just depend on the connected component of this space XR. Right? So this is another motivation to define this pi 1 SL2R. Now we have seen that this pi 1 SL2R is somehow the algebraic analog H0 X to Z. And we have lots of result. We know the lots of result about this group H0 X to Z. And then we are working that whether all the results of this group H0 X to Z has the algebraic analog for this pi 1 SL2R. So this is another. And by that way, I'm going to discuss the property of pi 1 SL2R. So if you take any ring homomorphism from R to S, then we'll we can find a group homomorphism from pi 1 SL to R to pi 1 SL to R, which is defined like that. So if you take, suppose I'm taking R is the coordinate ring of the real affine variety real point XR, then look at the real points of RX, polynomial ring over this ring. So that means that will be the XR cross R. And you know that if X is a topological space, then X and X cross R have same connected component. So that means that H0 XR to Z and H0 XR cross R to Z has a isomorphic group. So I will ask, one can ask whether this question true for pi 1 SL2R also. So I will, this theorem says that yes, this is also true for that one. So that means for any ring, this pi 1 SL2RX is the isomorphic to pi 1 SL2R. Moreover, So in one, and this is in general to pi 1 SL2 R X1 X2 XL is isomorphic to pi 1 SL2 R. And this is to we can see the proof by as I said any ring homomorphism is a group homomorphism from pi 1 SL2 R to pi 1 SL2 S. So by that way you know the ring homomorphism from it R X to R. Just taking F X to goes to is constant LA. Constant coefficient, right? So that gives a group homomorphism pi 1 SL2 RX to pi 1 SL2 R, and this one can see that this is a little bit technical to prove this is a group I, but it is a group isomorphism. Once you are able to prove this is a group iso, then by induction we can prove the for in general. So this is true. Now another way, if you take any ring, the ring and it take I is the nil radical of R, then R and R by I have the same real affine variety. So the same thing, that means they have same number of connected components, they are same. So that means you can ask whether this is true for this pi 1 SL2. Then the result, the next theorem says that it is also true for that. Pi 1 SL2 R is the same thing as pi 1 SL2 R mod or mod I. Right, and then this next theorem is also just algebraic analog of this result. H not Z is the isomorphism of H not X, direction of H not Y, where X and Y are disjoint open subset of Z, and Z is the union of this one. So that is the next. Next theorem is just algebraic analog of this one. Now I'm going to discuss about what is the binding number. So binding number is just if you take any loop from in R2 minus zero, so that gives a you can this gives a loop in S1. Right, it's in circle, and then consider the standard covering space of S1. We'll get a lift from I to R, and that difference becomes a integer, g tilde my one, and that is called binding number of this loop F. And this is few results one can see from any topology book. Binding number, what is that? If F and F dash free homotopic, then their binding number are equal. And if you take F dot F dash, this multiplication in S1, then binding number is just a sum of that one. So if, for an example, if you take this one gt equal e to the power 2 pi I, this binding number is 1. So by using this result, I'm going to define what is the binding number of an element in pi 1 SL2 R, where R is a field of real numbers. So if you take any element in this one, so that first column alpha t gives a map from it gives a loops in R2 minus 0. And that loops, then once we have looped, then we can talk about the binding number. And that binding number is of the first column given by this is called the binding number of this element alpha t. So once we have this one, so we get an by this binding number, we get the surjective group homomorphism from pi 1 SL2 R to Z, right? But and we know that if you look at this topological analog, that means H naught R to Z, this is isomorphic to Z because R has only one connected component. So that means, but there is only surjective homomorphism. So there is an open problem. We propose problem that whether this is an isomorphism or not. But we got a surjective one. So this is all about whatever I want to talk here. And these are the few references. So thank you for your attention. If anyone have any questions.
Thank you, sir. Now we are looking forward to the questions from the audience. Please unmute yourself and ask your question. You can also ask your question through chat box.